Our text this morning is from our second reading, Romans Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. This is our text. Gracious God, we thank you once again for simply allowing us, enabling us to gather around your word and sacraments to participate and celebrate in the baptism, to receive your body of blood, to be reminded that indeed you are near to us, speaking words of comfort and hope and peace in the midst of the storm of life that we have. Now, God, I pray once again that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our collective heart would indeed be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength. You are our Redeemer, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
So there is a lot of uncertainty in our world. When we hear words like North Korea best not make any more threats to the United States, they will be met with fire and fury like the world has never seen. We look at the news and read about and hear about things that are going on in Virginia, and it causes a sense of uneasiness and uncomfortableness. We've got students, as you do every year, who are going off to school, and some for the very first time. And while we are celebrating their achievements, there's a little bit of uneasiness as some of them go away to be on their own. Supply list is out. School orientation is scheduled. The plans are underway for a new school year. What will the teacher be like? Some may wonder. Will I make new friends? Can I play sports? Will I be able to get on the cheerleading squad or the drill team or whatever? We have questions. We deal with uncertainties all the time. It's a questionable season, even as football begins again. There are questions about what this team will be like, or what that team will be like, or what this team will do, or who's going to make it to the Super Bowl. Questions, uncertainties abound all around us. But for just a few moments this morning, there is something that we can be sure about. There is something in the Word of God that gives us certainty. You don't have to doubt. You don't have to worry, wonder about your salvation.
Amen.
You don't have to doubt if your faith will sustain you or not. You and I don't have to fear for our salvation because it is done. It is complete in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. God sends his word near to us, among us, to assure us that our salvation is secure and that we can live confidently with the blessed assurance that salvation and heaven right now belongs to us. In our reading from Romans chapter 10, the word of God has created a burning desire with St. Paul for sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul, as you know, was a very intentional man. He did what he did on purpose. He said what he said for a reason. He was concerned about, and he demonstrated his concern about the lost members of the family of faith. He said in Romans 10, brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God is that they be saved. We live in a world today that is not unlike the world that St. Paul lived in when it comes to believers and unbelievers. We have brothers and sisters, friends and family who are lost, who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Their lives matter, and we have a message from God that will indeed save sinners, reclaim backsliders, and encourage believers.
Amen.
We've got a word that has made a difference in our lives, and it will make a difference in the lives of others, and that's why we've got a story to tell. Now, let's be very clear. It's not our job to save anybody.
Amen.
We can't change anybody. We can't save anybody. But we can share the good news with everybody.
Amen.
tell anybody who will listen what the Lord has done for us. And that was St. Paul's point as he proclaimed the good news. Even Jesus, when John sent word to Jesus and asked him, are you the one? Remember what Jesus said? He didn't say go back and tell John to do anything. He simply said go back and tell God what you have seen and what you have heard. Our task as believers, my task as a preacher, is to tell about the goodness of God. Our task is to tell the world around us by what we say and by what we do that Jesus loves us, forgives us, will pick us up, will turn us around, will save us in the midst of the storm of life. We are blessed today to celebrate the baptism of London and Brooklyn on this very special day. And we are blessed to celebrate this baptism not because they are cute, and they are. We are blessed to celebrate this baptism not because it would have been Ms. Byers' 100th birthday, and it is, but we are able to celebrate this baptism because God loved them from the cross. God desires their salvation. Indeed, he desires the salvation of the world. Question for us is, do we have that desire for the world around us, for the lost around us? Are we really interested in being the church of the Reformation today? Do we have a desire that all may be saved? Or are we caught up with worrying about the bills that we have, or paying for our health plan, or how are we going to deal with the cost of education, or how are we going to deal with the rising cost of the utilities that are coming this fall? How concerned are we really about the lost who are around us? St. Paul seems to feel the burden for the lost. And perhaps St. Paul felt the burden for the lost because he remembered what the Lord had done for him and where God had brought him from. How many of us know today that the Lord God has been good to us? How many of us know today that the Lord has brought us from a mighty long way? How many of us can really just be transparent and put it on the line and tell the honest truth and declare that if it had not been for the Lord on our side, we would not have made it this far? Anybody know from personal experience that we serve an incredible God who does awesome things in our lives on a regular basis? And not because we deserve them, but that's just how good God is to us. St. Paul knew a little something about the goodness of God. He knew something about being snatched from the very jaws of hell. St. Paul knew a little something about having a light turned on while he was walking around in the darkness. He knew something about being lost and yet thinking he was on his way to heaven. You know the story. You remember when his name was Saul. You remember when he was a persecutor of the church. You remember that he was present at the stoning of Stephen. You remember his story. It may not be your story, but it is a story of godly deliverance. Yes. And we should all be able to relate to God delivering us from storms, even after he brought us to faith. As a matter of fact, some of us may have encountered a storm just to get here this morning. And if we encounter a storm to get here, we may be going back to deal with the storm later on. And there are some stormy situations in our world and in our lives and in our nation and in our communities and all around us. And we, the people of God, gather together, standing in the gap, calling on the power of God and the love of Jesus for all. That's what we're going to do tonight at 7 o'clock on the square. We're going to call on God and acknowledge the power. The word of God is near to us in spite of the storms that are going on around us. The word of God is near to us, and being near to us, it exposes our own guilt. We too have seen God do great things. We have seen the mighty grace of God is sufficient and at work even when we may not be working as hard as we are. Thanks be to God. He still works. And he still comes near. And he still speaks to us in our situations. Thanks be to God that his word speaks even at times when we are silent. He still speaks even when the sickness is all over us. He still speaks when the job ends. He speaks when the day is long and the night is dreary. Our God still speaks. In the midst of a storm, he speaks at all. As a matter of fact, St. Paul identifies that the word of God is the faith that God gives to us. The faith to believe and trust in the power of Jesus, who, when we find ourselves sinking on the sea of life, reaches out his hand and pulls us up and enables us to press on. The songwriter says that he gives us a faith that will not shrink. I like to think about that. Faith that will not shrink. Our faith is a gift from God, and it will not shrink because it has its origins in the mind of God. Our faith, our God-given faith, enables us to confess, I am by nature sinful and unclean, but there's an amazing grace from God that has saved a wretch like me. We confess Jesus as our Lord because Jesus has paid the price at the cross. From the cross, as the world was sinking on the stormy sea of life, Jesus, the very one rejected by the ones that he came to save, rejected by the Jews at first, declared, your works can't save you. It is finished. At the cross, then we can declare it is well with our soul. We can worship the Lord because he has created in us a faith that sustains us. We can give him praise in the midst of the storms because he has brought us together one more time. We can worship in this place because he makes this place holy by his presence and he meets us in the waters of baptism. He meets us in our communion meal. He enables us to walk by faith. Not by what you see, but by what God promises to do and be in our lives. St. Paul would remind us in this text that the word is very near to us. The faith that God gives to us is strong within us, and it will not fail. The word of God became flesh and dwelt among us, and he's worthy of our goodness because he is not a respecter of person. Jesus loves all. That's why we welcome the children. Jesus suffered shame and died for all the children of the world. We can share the message with our word. We can tell the story without fretting because the promise of God in this text is that those who acknowledge Jesus as those who confess him with their mouth enjoy the salvation of God and will never be put to shame. Never be put to shame. Isn't that good news? We will never be defeated because Jesus is victorious and he is very near to us. Paul declared that those who confess Jesus as Lord, those who speak the good news, those who have the faith that God gave them can live fearless lives. People can chant whatever they want to chant. Leaders can challenge each other with their words and weapons. We are not afraid. We are not belittled. We walk with confidence. We talk with assurance. We stand boldly because of the word of God, the power of God, the peace of God, the deliverance of God is upon us. No matter what the haters, the chanters, the confused people of the world have to say, the word of God is upon us. The children of God. And he is near to us. His word saves us, sustains us, yes, keeps yes, us now and forever. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Faith in God, we thank you for your word, which comes to us to remind us of your promises and your power in our lives. God, we stand on that word of comfort. Now, O God, may your peace which surpasses all the